And without further ado, I give you Kathy Kennedy Llamas, Mary Todd Lincoln.
In interviews, I am often asked, oh yes, I am still much sought for interviews. I think the press thinks to keep my husband alive through my memories. I'm often asked for a rendition, a chronological recitation of my life. I find that impossible. My mind seems to refuse chronology. The events refuse to align themselves in a logical order. It is as though Mr. Brady's magical flash powder explodes at intervals. Each picture is vivid and focused, but illogical with reference to time. At this moment in time, I am preparing for exile. And in this moment, it seems that I must try to order events for me, simply for myself. I must try to put in order that which can never truly be ordered. I must create order. One embarks upon a journey with feelings mixed, both anticipation and a certain anxiety bordering on fear is the root feeling of the undertaking. With each new mode of transport, be it accommodation stagecoach or river steamer, with each change of weather bringing either dust or mud to transverse, and each turn in the road or bend in the river, something new. In the spring of 1837, at the age of 18, I left Lexington on the first extended journey of my life to visit my sister, Elizabeth, down in Springfield, a journey of some 2 or 3 weeks. The house of my father and my stepmother, Betsy, had never been large enough in spirit to accommodate a first wife's children. With the birth of each new child, that house would contract, as would the spirit of the woman who from her constant birth and bed ruled my small sphere. I could not know then the extent and scope this initial journey would encompass, only to say that in Springfield, my cousin John Todd Stewart had recently accepted a new law partner, a man with a rather unlikely name of Abraham Lincoln. Oh, spring water, one of the more enjoyable assets of being in Springfield, and ever so much more healthy than drinking the Potomac. I shall be leaving here shortly, and these physical things will accompany me. These trunks with my gowns, my laces and properties will go where I go. They will never again be of use to me in ways originally intended, but I must have them. For they are my life. If not used, then they shall be fingered, held, touched. They shall remind me that I have been places and I have touched lives. That once I was a force. Now I'm simply waiting. I'm standing in a line, and that line is getting shorter. Soon I shall reach the front of the line. And the gentle difference between this life and what follows will dissolve. And once more, I will be accepted. It has been a very long time since I felt a sense of belonging. But I shall find the place where the hands of those I love will touch me again. My grandfathers, Robert Parker and Levi Todd, were drummers of a sort. salesman touting an inland utopia. Luring settlers to sparsely populated near wilderness areas with promises of greatness to come. The birthing of Lexington was not an easy one. Its labor long and painful. The final result at the time I was born hardly near in the description that was used to entice new settlers. They both were ambitious and used a formula that eventually worked. Start out a big fish in a little pond and then enlarge the pond around you. The final result was a certain amount of power and wealth that could never have been obtained had they begun in equal competition with other men in a pond of an already established dimension. I do not mean to detract from what they did. Simply let it be known that I know how they did it. I was the fourth of six children born in rapid succession. Both my mother, Eliza, and father, Robert, adhering to the custom of the day. Women of the time were either pregnant or nursing. And when their bodies wore out, they died. Leaving the husbands free and ready to begin a second family with a second wife. If this analysis seems cold, it's because it is cold. The truth often is. Few families of the time were raised by a single mother. As a middle child, I fought for attention, which was scarcely received, but it taught me well. In later years, I would have my fair share of focus, no matter the length I must go to achieve it. Look at me, Mama. Please, please look at me. Mammy Sally's dressed me fine for church. I won't sit down. I won't get wrinkled. I'll stay away from the wall till it's time to go. Look at me, Mama. Mammy Sally says that my stitching is as neat as Elizabeth's, and I'll get even better. I practice on an old piece of gingham, and I pick the stitches out and do it again and again. See? Look. Mama, why don't you just lay down and let me rub your feet? I can't wait for a baby brother. Please, just lay down and let me rub your feet. I can help you. I can. Look, Grandma Parker says I'm not to play with the boys. I won't. I'll do what I'm told. Look, I'll be your best girl. No, no, and me. I don't want to go to church, Mama. I want to stay home with you. Look, my mother died when I was 6 years old. She left me for myself. My mother abandoned me. Where did Mama go, I asked. Silent tears upon you. Silent tears to weep. Patient smiles to wear through suffering hours. No answer to satisfy me. Only Mammy Sally to console. To tell me that if I was a good girl, that my mama could come back to me, that I could see her again. And Elizabeth, Mammy Sally says there's more to air than meets the eye. She says it's full, full, full to the top of people who have lived before and are only waiting to be called back. So you see, Mama must still be here. We'll call it tonight, Elizabeth. We will. Oh, and I'll rub a dead mole's foot when the sun first makes a little light. Can we do that, Elizabeth? One thing bothers me, Elizabeth. If the air is full, full, full to the top of spirit people, are we walking through them all the time? Or do they just get out of our way? I stayed up all one night, a small girl in a homespun nightshirt, huddles on the corner of the summer porch, holding a dead mole in my lap. And when orange cut across the dead dark of the east, I rubbed that creature's little foot. And although I did not see her, when the sun rose white hot in the distant hills, I knew that my mama was there. The realm of my education in those early years was a distant province inhabited nearly exclusively by men. Females of the species were afforded perhaps 4 years, with an emphasis put on those things deemed necessary to augment her useful function in the family unit. By this, I simply mean that a woman's mind was seldom challenged. Her curiosity seldom piqued, and her own definition of her worth swept safely under the carpet. Social instincts and proper female manners headed the curriculum, with a secondary emphasis, though never mentioned aloud, placed upon flirtation. To call it boring would be to understate the situation considerably. Looking back on that time, I am finally grateful that my stepmother never warmed to me and was indeed thankful not to have me live under the same roof as her, let alone be in the same room. That happy circumstance, coupled by my father's only slightly advanced opinion, afforded me 9 years of a formal education. 9 years. Having run out of social graces to pound into my head, I was allowed by the advanced Madame Mattel to enter areas usually not the prerogative of my sex. Two fields excited me beyond belief, that of history and politics, which are one and the same, if you think about it. What continuing adventure, what gambler's paradise this world of politics. A world to be changed by the force of one man or one idea embedded into the proper mind. Oh, to be part of such a thing, to be a force for the molding and manipulating the lives and destinies of others, while the very excitement of the prospect flashed before my eyes in a cacophony of sound and color that made my mind pound as though it were trying to escape my body and fly with the eagles. Or the hawks, as the case may be. Oh, could I ever in the world be part of such a thing? Somehow, even then, I knew it was true, because I knew that I could fly. History will have a difficult time in definition of Kentucky. How does one describe an abolitionist slaveholding state? A dichotomy well represented in Lexington itself, where one-third the population was owned by a not too great majority. I looked forward to leaving Lexington and visiting my sister Elizabeth and her husband Ninian down in Springfield. I'd grown tired of the social scene, where I had great difficulty, not in finding attractive young men, but finding those whose mental attributes could pace with my own. Females of my circle seemed mere decorative confection set on a path for snaring the proper fly. It was said that outside Paris, France, there was in Louisville more tintin and perfume and makeup than anywhere else in the world. When crusty Cassius Clay advised the Lexington Belles to free your slaves, make your own beds, wash your own clothes, toss off the corset and let nature form your bustle. I just had to giggle. I had no intention of giving up a grand manner dress. I simply intended to find a better setting in which to be appreciated. The man's legs were far too long and spindly to hold the bulk of what was above. His hips were narrow. His waist was narrow. The bulk of the man happened at the top of the tree. Shoulders so wide that I was sure no coat could be fitted without a tailor's adjustment. A neck just as long and disproportionate as the legs. How Adam's apple is great as the namesake. The head was huge. How could it be supported by the appendages I was looking at? His eyebrows were massive and hanging over to shade the eyes. How could he see through them? His voice was thin, not at all what one would expect. "I'm Abraham Lincoln," he said, and his voice cracked three times. "And I want to dance with you in the very worst way. I am Mary Todd," I said, and I was entranced. Our heroes are often freaks. Abraham was a freak of sight and sound, but he was a genius of mind. I will never, never forget the first time I saw that man. Legs far too long and spindly to hold the bulk of what was above, especially the brain. But it was not quite love at first sight. Our first meeting occurred on my second visit to Springfield, and I attempted to dismiss the man's image from my mind. But as so often before in my life, there came a second set of feelings. Feelings that told me when I looked at him, especially when he didn't know I was looking at him, that here was a man not of the common mold. A man who could, and quite possibly would, be capable of rising above his origins, his current state, and his own expectation. Someone, in short, who was capable of astonishing himself. It's a quality difficult to define, this potential for greatness. But I knew it was there, and I felt it quite surely. This instinct, this second sight of mine, had seldom failed me in my life, knowing that something would happen to the point of expectation. Why, Mr. Lincoln, you flatter me. It is so seldom that a gentleman will sit down and dance for the mere purpose of conversation. You ask me questions as though you really do expect to find my answers of some small value. But do let's sit down, for it strains my vocal cords to try to speak to a man as, well, as tall as you. For you are way up there, and I am way down here. Down here far enough, sir, to make a small observation. Mr. Lincoln, sir, are you aware that, I mean, so you know that, well, I couldn't help but notice, being way down here, that you are wearing one blue sock and one black sock. And I do believe that you could use some looking after. Our courtship had its shares of ups and downs, and at one point ended altogether. When it resumed, it was though the interruption never happened. We seemed to fit somehow. He was 10 years my senior, but in most aspects of daily social endeavor, I was the elder and more experienced. So after a courtship of ups and downs, and after I somewhat adjusted to his idiosyncrasies, I would never quite adjust to them all, and after he somewhat accepted my temperament, he never could quite accept it all. In November of 1842, I put on my sister's white satin dress, and I married that man while the wedding cakes were still warm from the oven. It was as though we both knew it was something we needed to do, yet do quickly, before either one of us had too much time to think about it. During the ceremony, I looked up into his face, and he looked down into mine. And our eyes, they said things. We had made from different elevations a connection with each other and let future lovers know that we loved. Men who are thought to become historical figures or people that we read about are scarcely thought of in terms of an ordinary passion. But do not mistake it. Passion is felt. Quiet times were ours. Much more quiet than I would have imagined I would enjoy. I was a wife and eventually a mother. My thirst for the quick life ebbed. The parties, the extravagant use of personalities to create an impression, all of these things ebbed. And I enjoyed being Mary from Springfield instead of Mary from Lexington. But politics would not remain quiet, and my husband's ambition would not remain quiet. Later, I would fan those embers. I would force movement of political action into my husband's head. Later, he would say that I had forced him into politics, but no. The truth is, I simply let him focus on what was already there. Later, I would have sorrowed having done such a thing. Politics. Such a natural element of my husband. So sweet, so down home, so what the vote and public wanted. They could not see his brain, his commitment, his mind. Well, for them, he did not. Twenty-two years in Springfield. The year following our marriage, my first son, Robert, was born in the Globe Tavern boarding house. Next, a move to a rented property. I would never get over my dislike of living in an unowned home. Even today, were it not for the treachery of my firstborn, I would own rather than wander. Treachery. We purchased the house on 8th and Jackson, and there remained until our fortunes took us to the capital. 3 years later, my delicate Eddie was born. And in 1850, Willie entered our lives, and in 53, Tad, through a most difficult delivery. Tad was born with an overly large head. Tad was short for his first nickname, Tadpole. Well, I was injured. That from that point to this, I have been plagued by what doctors seem pleased to call female distress. Coupled by uncooperative joint mobility and headaches beyond belief. But the most chilling time of those Springfield years began as a small cough, a slight fever. My Eddie had never really been a healthy baby. And that small, slight illness progressed. Not rapidly, but at an almost imperceivable pace. A slight deterioration each day. Barely noticeable at first. But then, oh Lord, the pitiful, helpless vigil. For 52 days. And 52 nights, an incredible suffering, always on the increase, never waning, creeping forward. Pain increasing in that tiny little body. Pain increasing inside my heart and inside my head. Oh Lord, a slow death is a horror beyond imagination to be witness of. And then, once over, that horror which had become an almost sole preoccupation is almost missed. Over. Done. Gone. A small life ended without experience. Stopped before starting. Then grief. grief, my own pattern of grief. Like my mother, my small, small boy deserted me. I was much alone. My husband's business, first of law and increasingly of politics, kept him often gone. But I took new life from this political band. And after I had domesticated Abraham's appearance to one more fitting for the winning of votes, I set out to be part of this new band. If my husband was to be the subject, then I became the adjective, modifying and giving color to his action. A political woman among sippers of tea and connoisseurs of gossip. Politics is the science of manipulation. It is the art of making the unwanted seem desirable and the uncomely seem attractive, all done with such sleight of hand as to make the most lowly and unpretentious of men feel as though they have had a voice which has been heard and heeded. They feel as though they have had a say in an outcome, when in truth they simply have been convinced that what they were once in disagreement with was what they had wanted all along. A woman is not supposed to figure this out. She is to press her nose against the window pane of all such knowledge and be convinced that what is happening on the other side under masculine direction is exactly as it should be, and that her husband, her father, her son will take care of all such things without pesky interference from the distaff side. Hogwash. I learned very early on to shake my head, yes, while I was shaking my mind, no. And better still, the way to go about it. My husband entered skillfully into politics, and I became part of that skill. Now, when you think about it, there is a modicum of humor in the molding of a very tall man and a rather short woman. Early in our relationship, when we were, as custom labeled it, seeing each other, he would be seen, but I was not. Out on the dance floor, when I could cajole him onto the dance floor, it must have looked to spectators standing alongside the wall that here was a very tall man standing amongst a group of revelers dancing with himself. His arms were held down as if holding on to something, but that something could not be seen. That something is me. And sometimes, Abraham's sense of humor, overcoming his sense of propriety, would pretend to lose me in the throng. And I would swirl and tap and enjoy my own movement to the music, and he would weave in and out amongst them all in an exaggerated attempt to find the little person that he had lost. And once he found me, oh, what a show he would make of it all. And then we would begin the charade again. By counting on our own private amusement, we amused others, and thus became the center of attention, noticed. Come the next minor election, they would remember the tall man and the short woman. Politics, as I learned early on, is as much about being remembered come ballot day for frivolity as it is being remembered come ballot day for boring issues being debated boringly over punch, cherry. Not my favorite. Abraham looked at me with an intensity on his face that I had not seen since the day that he announced that I would marry him. "Mary," he said, "if we are to do together what I should hope to do, then you must learn to laugh at fools and be very serious about unserious matters." And I finally understood. We had become public people. My husband was a politician. Later that night, as we were getting ready for bed, I said to myself, tall Abraham, short Mary, let him wonder. And then, after a small commitment to politics in the state of Illinois, and after a small confusion amongst political parties not being fully committed to a candidate, all of a sudden my husband was there, was a candidate. No one could oppose him. And all of a sudden I was a candidate's wife. It was as it should be. Oh, could it happen? President and Mrs. Lincoln. And the culmination, on November 6, 1860, 3 months after the convention in Chicago, which resembled a game of cutthroat chess amongst ambitious men, and after 3 more months of relentless campaigning, my husband came to the door of our much-lived-in home on 8th Street and announced, "Mary, Mary, we are elected!" Well, our journey from Springfield to Washington by rail began on a note of jubilation, but ended in fear. We stopped by every city of note to greet the public and show ourselves to the crowd. There were shouts of approval for Abraham and a great insistence that Tad, Willie, and myself be a part of that general feeling of celebration. But there had also been threats of assassination. And under advice of Mr. Pinkerton, my husband left the train secretly at Harrisburg and continued through Baltimore to the Capitol, leaving the three of us to continue on the special service train. All was calm till we reached Baltimore. The train slowed to a halt outside the station, and I could hear a noise of a great crowd up ahead. The few words I could distinguish sent a feeling of fear through my body. "Black ape! Bring us the black ape!" they shouted. Mr. Pinkerton's agent told me to remain in my compartment with the boys and to keep the shades drawn low. The noise grew louder, and I peered beneath the blind, and I could see a great crowd surging out of the station, out towards the train. "Bloody Republican," I heard, "and traitor, and black ape." They were pushing against the train now, looking in the windows, trying to board. Things were being thrown, and somewhere I heard the shattering of glass. The noise got louder. Tad started to cry. Willie stood by the door with his hands clenched tight in a fist, trying to see my brave protector. But the train lurched forward and began a slow and steady progress through the station out towards the open track. But the men, they still followed, shouting and banging on the side of the cars. Until at last the train picked up speed and they were left behind. But for miles, I still heard their voices, the sound that of hate and violence. And with my boys clung tightly to my side, the throbbing in my head of danger evaded but not vanquished, I entered Washington. My first glimpse of the executive residence at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue appalled me. We moved directly into Willard's Hotel. The so-called White House was anything but white and resembled, to my mind, a slightly glorified rural estate that had certainly seen better days. I dubbed it the executive pig pen, and I began immediate plans to do something about it, not before or since Dolly Madison had a first lady been much seen or heard from. And I intended to rectify that in an instant, if not always, positive celebrity. I could see no sign in the place of any of the $20,000 allowed each president for the renovation and upkeep since Mr. Harrison. My thought was to use my own allowance, plus an amount equal to each of the previous administrations if necessary. Victoria of England and Eugenie of France did not live in squalor, and Mary of Washington had no intention of doing so either. The war was accelerating, and indeed troops of the Southern Conspiracy were on my very doorstep. It concerned me only in the amount of time it would take to end the hostilities and begin the business of running a singular nation. Politics may bring about the war, but politics do not wage the battle. I wanted this war over, and the much more interesting machination of political events to resume their usual and interesting course. Besides, while my husband always had an ear for my opinion of political issues, he was little interested in my slight knowledge of warfare. I turned my attention to other things, satisfied in my mind that the war would eventually settle itself into proper favor. Already considered a Confederate sympathizer because of my background and because of my Kentucky family support of Mr. Davis, I filled what function I could in support of our cause, but turned my major energies into creating an image worthy of national leadership. Only the finest draperies, china, crystals, wall coverings would do, and I set out to find them. Accompanied by the Commissioner of Public Buildings, Mr. William Wood, I began a series of trips to Philadelphia and New York, seeking out only the finest of goods through merchants of considerable reputation. Mr. Wood passed vouchers through the Treasury, and my accumulations of goods to transform that pigsty into a formidable residence of fashion had begun. The redecorating, coupled by my visits to Washington hospitals, became my two main occupations. And if the press condemned the first activity, they at least acknowledged the second by a modicum of praise. By October of 1861, the White House had been refitted to a proper standard. And if this makes me enemies, so much the better. Show me a person of real influence who has no enemies, and I will show you a person operating under grand illusion. The war dragged on, but I rose above it and became, to my mind, a close to perfect figurehead and proper adornment for the head of state. After my first entertainment in my new home, rather an unveiling of sort, I was exhausted. My breath had been taken away so many times that night. I was gasping. Imagine me, Mary Todd of Lexington, Kentucky, the first lady of the land. They're all gone now. All gone. The guests, the favor seekers. I use a word my mother often employed after a celebration, a party, or a wedding. The place was a havoc. I looked around and tried to put together in my head a way to begin the cleaning and clearing up. I must have looked rather silly in my new French gown as I began the process of cleaning and clearing away. Old habits die hard. From behind me, I heard the clearing of a throat. I turned and I faced a negress about my age. She said again, and with more authority, "I'll take care of this. We take care of this." I didn't know what to do. I started up the stairs and I looked back. There were a half a dozen young women already cleaning and clearing away. These are the very people, I thought to myself as I left my triumphant evening. These are the very people that my husband wishes to free, and yet we use them. They're cleaning up our mess. I have been called mean-minded. I have been called a petty woman. I have been called selfish. And in one particularly abrasive cartoon, I was pictured as a shrew. My face, the body of a rodent. I can only smile with a smugness born out of self-knowledge. All the above adjectives all correct. But to try to justify them to you would be petty. But as I have been called such a thing, I shall be it. Petty. Choose not to listen if you think that I will make excuses, because I will not. Justify? I will not. I suppose to many I am not a very nice woman. I am mean-minded, in that I will accept no abuse from my lesser. If you are lesser than me, figure it out. You may be abused by me. I am mean-minded, in that I will accept no abuse from my better. If you are better than I, figure it out. I will find a way through my position to better you. Selfish? Oh, yes. Much more selfish than you could ever imagine. Selfish for goods unavailable to me at a time when goods were important. Food goods. Goods of adornment. They say that I own 100 pairs of gloves, and they are correct. I bought them, they are mine. I was the first lady, and I am selfish. The face of a woman on the body of a shrew. I do take offense at that. I would much more my face be atop a chameleon. Much more to my liking and much more me. If you do not care for the Mary who speaks to you now, don't worry, I shall change. You see, I speak pleasantly to erase the knowledge that I have just imparted. But I need to rest. I need lavender water. And I need to find a flower. Perhaps I will find one. And perhaps you will be here when I return. And if you are, you will hear me speak of my sons, the death of my husband. And perhaps that is the only reason you are here, to hear from a witness, a participant in the events. Be that as it may, I would like just now to find a flower. Abraham was a pale, pale white. His veins showed blue through his skin. He covered his pale being in a black suit, but they shone through for me. Me? Robust color in the body, draped in white to cover the readiness, the willingness. Oh, how the colors change. How often can an easily rendered statement be turned back, edited by the minds of others, and become a killing and hurting thing? I wish my son could die, I said. And I did say it. After sitting beside him through a horrible night of sweat, randomness of thought, and uncontrollable movement of the bowels, I looked down on him, and I looked into his sweet face, white, no color, and I thought to myself, how many more nights like this? And I sipped as I left his room to change my clothes and eat a little before I returned. I said, I wish my son could die. In the hallway repetition, the echo of my voice saying these words down the hallway, repeated by servants. Mrs. Lincoln wants her son to die. She wants to be unencumbered by the boy. These are the words that fell on the public ear. I did not care. I bathed. I ate a little. And I returned to Willie's room. He was so quiet. And he looked so small on that big bed. I knew when I looked at him, before I even held his hand, I knew that it was over. And his nurse came to the door. Mr. Lincoln is inquiring, she said. He wants to know the condition of his son. Well, tell Mr. Lincoln, I said. Tell him that his son is... Tell him his son is as well as can be expected. She left, and I was once again alone with my boy. I put a cold cloth on his face, and I sat down beside him. The public would say that Mrs. Lincoln had gotten her wish, that she was unencumbered by the boy. Well, the public is often stupid. The unencumbered Mrs. Lincoln sat through the night holding the hand of her dead son, unwilling to admit to the world as to admit to herself that that small life existed no more. When I was finally taken from the room the following morning, I could only say that perhaps he is not dead. And then I heard that nurse say, Mrs. Lincoln does not know her son is dead. And so these things, these words that one speaks, go into the mouths of others and echo down the hallway. What a bad mother she was. She paid more attention to society than she did her own son. I learned then, a person in the public eye, a celebrity of public favor, is expected. No, it is demanded for that person to make a public display of their caring, no matter how deep, to a public waiting to feed on it. How horrible. That was my failure. That was one of my failures. I could never, I will never, no matter how deep, display it for the purpose of public consumption. I took my grief over the death of a child to my private places, and the general consensus was that I did not care, because I had not made a public declaration of my care. An addition to reputation. The reputation of the cold, uncaring Mrs. Lincoln.
Oh, Willie, would I could have given you some years of my own. Oh, some leftover years of my own.
I looked to mourn him twofold through the pain my husband felt. Abraham could pretend with great credibility. He pretended in public appearances that he had accepted as an inevitable gift the cessation of the suffering of his son. But in private, he wept. Oh, how tired I was of bearing witness to his private tears, shared with no other person. After all, his son was my son too. I turned my face to another wall, a wall never to be broken through, a wall that existed between the world that we know, and whatever lies beyond. And yet to me, draped in black and dismissed as a person who had turned her back on certain realities, that one blank wall was more friendly, more inviting than the coldness of being alone. I did not deal with bad people during these times. They were sincere and believed in what they did. If from time to time a true charlatan appeared on the scene, I seemed to know somehow, and I ridded myself of that person. Perhaps it was the belief in the innocence of those who truly believed that they could accomplish miracles, that I accomplished the miracle of living, albeit without the love of living, for so many years after. Abraham says that more will be written about the Civil War than any other time in our country's history, so I will not dwell on it. I will let the historians make of it what they will. Pain. The waste of brothers' lives in separate cause. Loss. I will only say that it ended. The war was over. And I was first lady of a country. Still an island split between hatred and ambition, but a singular country. I had never been an onlooker, a watcher of events. I had breeding, and I had a vision, and money was at my command. Use it, Mary, I told myself, and I did. Mrs. Lincoln was denied nothing. I was acknowledged a certain recognition through the habit of my spending, and I spent money. But in the end, I spent far less than Abraham. He spent himself. In 1865, the month of April, my husband had a dream. In 1865, the month of April, on a night far too hot for that time of year, I lay awake and listened to the sound of my husband's sleep. I put my hand on his head. It was wet. He was sweating in a part of sleep I could not share, in a world I was not part of. Something was not right. I did not know. He threw himself suddenly to the foot of the bed and sat there with his head in his hands. He was shaking so hard. The bed was moving. The only sound was the creak of that old bed. I lit a lamp and I put my hand on his shoulder. He pushed me, the only violent act of a lifetime. Pushed me away and onto the floor. He breathed hard, like a bloodhound. And I was afraid. "I've seen it," he said. And he said it quite loudly. "I felt it," he said, and he was crying. I tried to touch him, and again, he pushed me away. With his hands, he pushed himself to his feet. I did not think he could stand long. I tried to touch him to offer what small support I could, and again, he pushed me away. He felt his way over to the window and looked at it. He did not see beyond the glass. He looked only at what was happening to him in a dream. "I've seen it," he said. "I felt it," he said. He turned, and because I was behind him, offering my small support, he pushed me away. He made his way over to the bed and sat. He locked his hands, his large, his huge hands, like a vice against his brow, as though he were trying to squeeze the vision in his mind out of his thoughts. He pressured it. Failed. His hands were strong, but not strong enough to stop his mind. And then he fell back on the bed, But I could not go near him because I was afraid. And then he said, oh Lord, I hear his words even now. He said, oh Mary, my small Mary, my Mary, I have felt it. And the next time it comes, it will not hurt like this. Because the next time it comes, it cannot last so long. And I won't finish. I will not see my task to completion. Mary, I have felt the busting open of my head, the end of my brain. And when it comes, and tonight I have seen it, and I know that it will come, it will not hurt like this. What will hurt is that I did not finish. I could cope no more on that night in April of 1865. I went into Willie's room and I curled up on the empty bed. I left my husband alone with his premonition. I tried to negate it by holding up the spirit of our dead son like a piece of armor. I went with my husband that night to the theater. I was bored with the idea of seeing for the third time a play which held no interest for me, and I should hope for the majority of a thinking audience, our American cousin. My boredom would be vanquished that evening, never to be returned again. A singular event that would alter history, alter me and send me into a world from which return would be impossible. I am not mad. I have never been insane. I simply have entered a moment in time from which there would be no return ever. A singular moment. But does history ever see the reality of blood that's on its hands? Not the reality that's translated to readers and books, but the blood that is warm and sticky and congeals quickly with a scab over the top and can be wiped away and again become moist. Oh, the lies of history. Dried blood on pages. This is Abraham sitting beside me. A man who I had admonished all too thoroughly for not wiping his shoes before entering my parlor. A man who I had severely criticized for indulgent behavior with his sons, my sons. Abraham, who had swept me away into the unfathomable mire of Washington society and who made me mistress of a house of an enormous size, such as Abraham. And the play began, and it was, as I suspected, a bore. A sound behind the curtain that housed our box, a slight sound. Security so well provided. A hand holding a gun, an instrument of instant destruction, a sound, I hear it. laughter covering the inadequacies of a second-rate play, but I hear the sound. Abraham, who will not wipe his shoes, is laying on the floor of a first-rate box in a first-rate theater. Nobody hears it. The laughter is immense. The play goes on. And I am on the floor of a first-rate box, holding my husband's dying head in my hands. Someone leaps over my head, out of the box and onto the stage, or the floor of the stage. I try to reach up to grab some part of him before he descends, but I fail. And there's blood now on my gown, on my shoes, on every part of me. Booth, they say, is the name of the man who leapt over my head. He hit the stage hard and something snapped. Perhaps it was a bone, I do not care. They say this man Booth was hunted down, but I do not care. They say that he was hung or killed, but I do not care. The play was finally stopped. Some minion finally noticed that a president lay dying. Somebody noticed. When help arrived, I was looking at a face I had never seen before. Abraham's face had always been divided from me. I called the left side of his face the quick side, the side that was always aware of the country and whatever might be going on, whatever his duty might be. Right side of his face. That was the side that I loved. Where's Toddy? What's Eddie doing? Are you doing well, Mother? He asked me that quite a lot. Are you doing well? His eyes just look so big. And then they acted. Shall we move him? Yes, I yelled. Take him across the street. I was yelling then. Take him across the street and let him die in a bed, I yelled. And they did. They carried him across the street and put him in a bed that was far too small for his giant frame. And then he died. They left me there, in that dark place, in that dark place. They took my husband, but they left me. And I found myself. I had been left to follow. I would stand up, cross the corridor, descend the stairs, cross the street, and enter the house of a tailor. I felt the velvet in my gown becoming stiff. My husband's blood, I thought. I entered the house and I went up the stairs into the bedroom where my husband lay dying. I looked at what was left of him. I turned and left the room. My life with him was much before this time. He is not, I thought, as history would treat him, but he is mine. And I left the room. Some 9 hours later, it was over. How does one convey to a nation that the sorrow of a nation can be held in one bosom? One does not. This nation seems not to want to share its sorrow with me. I am the outsider. Well, nation, I shall not share either. We shall go separate ways, and you will regard me with little attention. and I shall keep it secret. I shall pretend that you have some care. It is to save my dignity for myself that I do this. But let me speak, nation of anger. Are you angry that you have lost your leader, the helmsman of all? Are you? Oh no, you are bewildered and are waiting to be led again. And you will be by another. Am I angry that I have lost? Oh yes, I am furious. Belittle me as you will, but you will move on and be easily taken into a new time by other leaders. I will stay behind. As you acquiesce and move forward, do not look back at me. Simply leave your sorrow, that which you will abandon behind you, and I will pick it up. Leave it for me to tend. I will stay here and plant it in a time I cannot leave. I can hold it. I can carry it next to my own. Leave yours for me. I can pack it. I can tamp it down. I will carry it. My hate for this country and my love for this country are one and the same. You move on, and I hate that. I cannot, and I hate that. Once, we were connected by a single thread of humanity. One person, and I love that. Move on, leave me as quickly as you can. I prefer to stay behind. When I was a girl, I did not know. I did not care to contemplate what I might become. When I was a girl, everything was new. It was to be discovered. Now I am not a girl, and those discoveries have been made. But then, until that tall man walked into my life, I was a girl. Without him, I still might be young. He brought me knowledge of a world that I helped him to attain. He brought me children, mine. And they brought me to my knees. When I was a girl, I was larger than I am now. Belittled by history, I will be. That does not make me less than what I am. I tried so hard, but history will not record the trying, only the failure. I don't think Abraham was ever young. I think he was born old and carrying the burden. I try to picture him before the day I met him, but I cannot pierce that time. I try to imagine him, say, at the age of 12, sitting with his family at an evening meal, but I cannot picture him not at the head of our table. The legends, of course, were already sprouting. The rail splitter, the boy who took action in all events, but I cannot see it. I try, but I can't. Perhaps we make our heroes too big. Perhaps we forget that our heroes come from a common beginning, that they were susceptible to diseases of childhood. that they lied to their parents to escape punishment, and that they, no matter what they were destined to be, all deserved a spanking as a child. Ted? Ted? Ted died of pleurisy at the age of 18. I will not iterate my grief except to say it was as though I was performing a well-rehearsed role. So many times before had I played that part. Abraham, Edward, William, Ted, Thomas, Abraham, Felix. I can feel what is not there. In the past, I touched you, and I can touch you now. Feel you. Oh, I can feel. The train. I hear the train. Boys, hide. Abraham, help the boys. Keep them safe. Don't let. Read your lessons. Don't catch a chill. Oh, take your shawl. Feelings. Oh, close. Stay close. Keep me warm. Oh, touch me again. Don't let them hurt me anymore. Don't let anyone hurt me anymore. When I was young and full of grace, I did not need a hiding place. They took you all the way. I'm hiding now, and here I'll stay. Oh, touch me again. Oh, Abraham, I hurt. My bones, they hurt. But I'm not alone. I don't grow old alone. Willie, oh Willie, don't catch cold. Wear your scarf. The rain is coming all around with cold and wet and thunder sound. The lightning makes the night like day. It's easy now to find our way. Oh, Willie, brush Mama's hair. Make it smooth. Smooth like silk. Oh, Mama's gonna buy you some new toy soldiers. Oh, Abraham, oh, hold on to me, make it go away. They don't know, they never know. Mary is not alone. Oh, Abraham, the baby's crying. Hold the baby. Hold the baby, Abraham. Hold on to Mary. Are you alone? I am never alone. And came a time when I was forced to examine a word which up until that time in my life had been applied only to others, and mostly in a manner non-serious and mocking. Why, what an insane hat Mrs. Stanton wore tonight. I do believe she's making her own designs. Mr. Seaward is virgin on the insane. We are in the middle of a war, and he will not stop harping about the frozen acquisition to the north, which can only be fit for viewing through a kaleidoscope. The Davises are all insane about the new play down at the Ford. I hear that Mrs. Keene is a comedian of insane proportions. Insane. Now I must look at this word from a new perspective. Now I'm Mary and being considered the subject of that adjective and by my own son. I think people view as insane any action that differs from their own particular point of view. And in that context, I am insane. My view is not the view of others. For the first time in my life, I worry about that. My son, Robert, would have me incarcerated, have me put under a pillar. He would not have to deal with me then. He may very well succeed. But small warning from small Mary. Small Mary will not stay there. She will find a way, as she always has, to slither from under that onus and be heard from again. Insane or no. My son Robert has, in an idiom from my childhood, bitten off much more than his dentally unequipped mouth could possibly do. But it does hurt that a singularly genetically connected person could do such a thing to a genetically, to his mother. Insane. On a May morning, a particularly pretty morning as I recall, there was a knock on my door. I had been staying at the Grand Pacific, elegant, fitting. I had been, of course, shopping and had found at Gossage's and purchased 8 elegant, but not to say expensive, pair of curtains of a particularly fine lace. I was expecting delivery. Instead, 3 men, one led in sweat, who had nominated Abraham at the convention in 1860, and 2 others, uniformed, unknown to me. Mr. Sweat told me something, and so awful were his words that, although I understood them, my mind shut them out, and I had to ask for repetition 3 times. He was, he said, to take me at once to the courthouse where a jury lay in wait for the purpose of judging my sanity. Well, upon hearing his words, I could hardly have reacted with much to prove a defense. If I were to proceed quietly, he said, he would accompany me to my judgment in his own carriage. And if not, I would be escorted by the others. Accompany him? I will not. Precede him I did, and in his own carriage. I was seated well ahead of the fool. In the court, I heard a parade of accusations that to this day I cannot totally recall in full. The reason being was the accusations were being thrown at me by my own son. I had been followed. I had been spied upon. I was on trial because I bought things. Because I saved things. Because I argued with clerks. Because I insisted on fair work from the hotel staff and fair exchange of good to my dollar. Because I had a voice that insisted be heard, and because I would not be swept into the corner and obey the unwritten law of what a woman should be. In short, I was being tried in such a manner because I was not a man. In a matter of minutes, a jury of 10, all men, reached a verdict of insanity and recommended immediate incarceration with no time given for defense. So, on to Batavia and Bellevue and the ministrations of Dr. Know-It-All DeWitt Patterson. At our first meeting, I was polite to the point of syrup. And at each meeting thereafter, I acquiesced. I cooperated. I was a friend to all. But in my mind, I was shouting, bastards, treachery. I was out of that hole in 3 months and 3 weeks. Only the very, very best can play a game with Mary and best her if she does not wish it, Robert. I achieved my release. And 36 years after my first glimpse of Springfield, I returned to the stewardship of my sister and a husband. I had been returned my right to judgment. I had been returned my financial responsibility. And I had lost forever my one remaining son. I do not wish to be in his company. No matter how long I shall live, not even for a second ever again. I end my life childless. So I shall take these trunks of goods and memories, and I exile myself to anonymity. I will go where I am not known. And I shall seek no friendship. If I am recognized, it will be for others to cope with the problem because I will not acknowledge it. I shall move a shadow in black from place to place and ask nothing, nothing of any man. And I shall never, never, never suffer future pain. Only that of the past. And it is such a part of me as to ensure no relief until I am finally granted silence. Because I was not as strong as I would wish, I leave only what unkind history might say. And perhaps unkind history will be correct. I will only say that I, Mary, loved my husband the best that I could. And that even now, despite moments that will challenge history to define them, I love him still. What does greatness smell like? What is the touch? The feel of history when it has not yet become history. What is the meaning of a word when one does not know that that word will be repeated and repeated until it becomes a part of heritage? For 67 years ago, what does the living of a life mean? When one does not suspect that during that living, moments would be repeated again and again in the words of those who analyze, dissect, and reorganize history. I was born into the Todd family, Lexington, 18. My given name is Mary. I began my journey on a spring day many years ago when I left my father's house in Lexington, Kentucky to visit my sister in Springfield, Illinois, a city where my cousin John Todd Stewart had recently accepted a new law partner. A man with a rather unlikely name of Abraham Lincoln. A woman, you know, always closes the door quietly.
see everyone.
Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here tonight and to share in Mary's story. I started working on this actually about 7 years ago, and then I took like a 5-year hiatus, and a friend had asked me to do a portion of it for Greenfield Savings Bank, actually. And I put it off for a number of years, and then I decided to do it. And when I took it back out again, I just fell in love with every word. Mm-hmm. And I just have such a connection to this piece, and I'm really glad I got to share it with all of you.
So we're